So what are you doing?
Nothing.
Nothing? Why not?
I'm trying to get on this lifestyle radio website.
Sounds like a cool website.
Yeah, it's alright. You might have it.
You're listening to Lifestyle Radio.
The opinions expressed during this show are those of the individual participants and do not necessarily reflect the opinions of their associated organizations or Lifestyle Radio.
Good afternoon and welcome to Pottawa. This is the audio version of a show that is 100 episodes deep on YouTube that was started almost exactly two years ago. And I was asked to do this show, a weekly one-hour show, similar to what we do on YouTube. And for the next sort of 20 minutes, I'll talk about myself and activism and things that I've done and who I am and why you should bother listening to me on my show. And we'll play a song. And then after that, we're going to look at some of the pot stuff that has to do with Ottawa specifically. But over the weeks, we'll be talking about other issues nationally, internationally, provincially, municipal, all this kind of stuff. So to get started, who am I? Well, I'm Russell Barth. I'm the host of the YouTube show Pottawa. We've done 100 episodes over the past 2 years. It started on February 13th of 2016, the day that Ottawa got hit with a blizzard of 40 centimeters in like about 9 hours or something. We almost didn't get home that night. But we got lucky, and we've been doing the show every week, pretty much every week ever since, me and my friend Nathaniel Newton. And before that, I pretty much made my name for myself in pod activism by becoming the most published letter to the editor writer in Canadian history, as far as I know. I've had over 830 letters published in Canada alone over the course of 8 years. From I guess it was 2003 to 2011, and mostly about drug law reform, and almost all of them in Canada. So as far as I know, no one else has ever had that many letters published in Canada, letters to the editor anyway. I also worked with my wife, Christine Lowe, and we published the world's first children's book about medical marijuana. It's called Mommy's Funny Medicine. Now, there's a lot of children's books about pot out now, and the second one that came out was called It's Just a Plant, and it was, I think, superior to the one that we did, but ours was the first, and we're very happy with it. We're still very happy with it, and, you know, there were 2,000 copies printed. It's been sent to different libraries and things, and that was in 2003 we published that. Other things that I've done in terms of activism in Ottawa is, for example, I've dressed up as Jesus in 2011, and 12 and crashed the Pride Parade. I had a big sign that said Jesus, Heart, Queers, and Pot. And there's a big pot leaf where the O should be. And of course, this was wildly popular. People wanted to get their picture taken with Jesus. And people address you as Jesus. You stop being the person you are and you start being the costume. You start being the character. It's kind of like dressing up as Mickey Mouse or Spider-Man or something. And since I had the hair and beard for it, I decided why not go as Jesus. So we did that, and, you know, pot's been pretty important in my life. I'm not quite the pot enthusiast, a lot of people are, but in 2002, I was in a wheelchair, not bum stuck, but I was sort of tethered to it, like a lot of old people you see with scooters and things. And my wife, who was at the time a roommate with benefits, Christine Lowe, she decided in May of 2002 that she wanted to quit using her pharmaceuticals for epilepsy and just start using cannabis. And I supported this, but I said, you know, if we're going to do that, we need to become activists. We can't be lurking around the cracks of this city trying to find medicine for you. We need to start talking about, you know, dispensaries and stuff. We need to start going public with this sort of thing. And she agreed. And we embarked on this journey, you know. So you really have Christine Lowe to blame for all of this. None of this would have started without her deciding that she was going to get into pot activism, that we were going to get into pot activism. So, you know, it started in 2002. We changed our diet. We changed our lifestyle. We started using cannabis, and Christine's seizures dropped off significantly. They dropped down from 60 seizures from January to May. She only had 13 more the rest of that year. She had 13 the following year, 9 the following year, 5 the year after that, then 3, then like 1 a year for a while. And then in 2008, she had a bunch of grand mal seizures in a half hour. I called an ambulance. They shot her full of drugs in the ER. She spent the night in the hospital, and I brought her home, and she hasn't been the same since. She's been having anywhere from 9 to 20 mild seizures per month, and one grand mal seizure, about 10 grand mal seizures per year, sort of one a month, but not every month, so we'll call it about 10 a year on average. And I'm her 24/7 caregiver. She's sitting behind me on the couch right now because she can't be working on the thing she wants to work on, which requires standing, because I'm busy doing the show, which is fine. She's working on her iPad. She never stops working. She's either doing something household requirements, chores like we both do, cleaning things up, dishes, food, and so forth, or she's working on her iPad, or she's having volcano because she needs medicine for her epilepsy, and or she's painting something. Right now she's working on some paintings. So, that's, you know, we're 95% of the time we're at home. So, you know, we're using cannabis on and off all day, pretty much. And unfortunately, for the past several years, we've been on charity. There's, you know, we lost our designated growers back in 2014 when the MMAR was shut down. And we are signed on to ACMPR, but there's been some difficulties with our designated grow. So, you know, we're still kind of getting by on a little bit here and there. And our grow has been okay for a while, but there's been some crop losses and stuff. So everybody's struggling. Things are changing. And so we're managing. So it's not like I'm this big pot enthusiast or I'm sitting around getting stoned all the time. I admit I spend a lot of my time playing Minecraft. I use it as harm reduction. It occupies a great deal of my thinking so that I can't spend my time just thinking about activism or thinking about the perils of my life dealing with someone who has very spontaneous and random seizures, sometimes in public. So that's what I do to keep from using, you know, drugs and alcohol and hurting myself, which is kind of what I'm inclined to do. I have, to backtrack a little bit, I have PTSD and fibromyalgia. I'm not sure exactly what caused the PTSD, but I was in a car accident where I took a pretty tough shot to the neck. I was about 18 or 19 at the time. And, you know, my neck was hyperextended, I was told. So they told me in the ER that, well, you know, it's going to hurt for a few days and that, but it'll get better. And then might give you some trouble later on. She said, what do you mean trouble? She says, oh, you know, stiffness, soreness, that kind of thing. She didn't talk about the weakness or the fact that I can sort of turn my head a certain way and it clicks really loud like people in the movies, or that I get, you know, electric shocks down my arms, or that I have the manual dexterity of a drunken 11-year-old. I can barely tie my own shoes. I can barely write my name or scribble out a phone number that I can read. So I spend a lot of my time typing. I'm a console man. I do not like iPad. And I like being at a keyboard with a mouse and everything. And so I spend a lot of time and on Facebook, and a lot of my Facebook friends are activists, people like Kirk Tusaw, David Malmo Levine, you know, Dana Larson, and a whole list of others, Chris Goodwin. And so I'm learning a lot about activism over the years, and I'm learning a lot about how things go on. So by most people's standards, I guess I'm an expert. By pot activist standards, I'm not really an expert, especially when you start talking about names like David Malmo Levine and Dana Larson and Kirk Tusaw. But I think I bring an interesting sort of spin to the whole pot activism thing. I seem to have a knack for explaining stuff in layman's terms. It seems to work pretty well on the show. I can take complex, convoluted issues and I can make it sound like something you can understand in a cheap diner. I spend bus rides. I end up talking to little old ladies and teenagers and other people. And I just get into these conversations. You know, having long hair and wearing a pot leaf t-shirt in public helps start those conversations. The pot leaf shirt says, you know, marijuana cures cancer. Look it up. You get little old ladies going, that's a terrible thing. You shouldn't be wearing that. Kids get addicted. I'm like, yeah, whatever, lady. Get an internet connection. And then you get other people going, is that true? Because I've heard some things. And then you start getting talking. And then another person's, I always like to have conversations loud enough that other people can overhear it. You know, not obnoxiously loud, but loud enough that a lot of people become within earshot. So, you know, and that's kind of, that's my way of doing activism. And my primary thing, a lot of people say, well, why don't you do this? And why don't you do that? My primary motivation in life is to take care of Christine. My primary duties are to take care of Christine. And, that really entails sort of just standing around and being available and asking her every 30 to 90 seconds if she's doing all right. And and then catching her when she starts to have a seizure, which could happen during the course of the show, by the way. So if there's suddenly a pause or suddenly this chatter ends and the music starts playing, it might be because Christine's had a seizure. You all right back there, Ange?
I'm just fine.
All right, good. Thank you. So, you know, as far as activism goes, we try to work as a team. She's less vocal than I am. She spends less time on Facebook. She comments less. She tweets less. I like to send challenging or some would say insulting tweets to politicians and especially journalists. I have a real problem with journalists and their lack of fact-checking or, you know, due diligence and scrutiny when it comes to cannabis issues. Cops, as we saw recently in York region, a cop told a bunch of teenagers, you know, pot makes you crazy. One joint's the same as seven drinks, and pot makes boobs grow on men, all of which is nonsense. And yet this was just reported like it was fact. This reporter didn't actually do anything or change anything or check any of these facts to see if they were facts or not. And this kind of stuff infuriates me. So it's part of the reason I started Pottawa. Part of the reason I called it Pottawa was it's kind of a pun name. I hate puns, and I especially hate puns when they're involving drug discussions. You know, high hopes for cannabis investors, you know, dispensary nipped in the bud. I mean, any kind of pun or wordplay that has to do, it seems that only journalists use words like looming, pocketbook, and, you know, still spin things in ways that they make a pun for a headline. Puns are the lowest form of comedy. You know, this is for children of 2 and 3 and 4 years old to begin to understand wordplay. And anything beyond that is just, it's, I mean, this is not, what are these, vaudevillians? You know, it's really infuriating. Every time I see one of these headlines, and I have to do this as my, you know, for my show every week, I go through a typical week as I scroll through my Facebook posts of the past week on Friday, and I pick the 20 or 30 or 35 different pot-related or drug-related stories. And I read them and I make some scroll videos and I analyze the situation and I decide what it is I'm going to say. And then on Saturday, Nate comes over with his computer and we go usually live and I comment on these stories. And when the show first started, we were at Buzz On, the first and only lounge in Ottawa for, you know, vaping or smoking pot. And it was open for a while, but it didn't stay open for various reasons. It was not shut down. It was, it shut down because it didn't have enough business, and it didn't have enough business because it didn't really have a lot of hustle to bring bums into the seats. So bums didn't come in and they started losing money and they didn't have enough money to face bylaws that were probably coming. So they shut down. Wasn't that scandalous a thing? It just didn't work out that well. So there was no home for our show. So we've been doing it live, mainly live, as I said, out of my apartment, Studio CBD here in Ottawa South. And, you know, we do a lot from here. You know, I managed to get the permit for 420 on Parliament Hill, which is an interesting kind of task you have to do. This started in 2018. So in 2016, there was some confusion about 420 and who was going to get the permit. And two people vied for the permit at the same time so that the committee gave them both permits. It was just a really confusing thing. And then when I went to see it, I realized at 4:20 p.m., the crowd started spilling up onto the steps where all of these instruments were. And people were tripping over wires and nothing got damaged, luckily. But, you know, there was way too many people standing around on a bunch of stairs with wires and instruments that could have been seriously damaged and someone could have been injured. So I said, that's it. I'm not allowing this for next year. So the next day, April 21st of 2016, I called and I said, yeah, I want the permit for 2017. And, you know, by May we had it and it went great, you know, and we did it the first with my friend Nate there and other people. We did the first live stream on YouTube of 420 in Ottawa. And, you know, 420 in Ottawa is an interesting thing because it's a terrible place, Parliament Hill. I mean, it's a big flat lawn that's sitting on top of a roof of another part of the building. I mean, it just seems like the ground, but it's actually the roof of a building. And it's a lawn. You know, it's 4 acres of grass with a big strip of stone walkway down the middle of it. And the steps are pretty cool, but the sound is terrible. if you crank it anything louder than a boombox, it starts bouncing off the east and west block, and it starts bouncing off the streets, the buildings across the street. So you get this fold over crisscross echo sound, and it's really, really bad. And on other shows, 2012, 2013, 14, there was big sound systems and the sound got too much. You couldn't hear anything. So we had to keep the sound down. So 2017, we did a really nice show. It worked out well. And we get the permit again for this year, 2018. And here's the tricky part. Parliament Hill is under construction. It's under a long-term, full-scale renovation. So come April 20th, we don't know exactly what's going to happen. So far, we have the permit, and by we, I mean Pottawa, Patients Lives Matter, a collection of, a loose affiliation of activists here in Ottawa is we, you know. Well, I'm the event coordinator. My name's on the permit anyway. So we have this thing for 420, but we can only use the west half of the lawn, which, as far as crowd size go, should work out. It's 2 acres instead of 4 acres, but people tend to spread out over the lawn. You can go see photographs and you can see time-lapse videos on YouTube. If you type in 420 Parliament time-lapse, and you'll see that, you know, the crowd comes milling in gradually, 4:20 p.m. There's this huge cloud of smoke comes off of it. And then everybody's gone in like 12 minutes. Like the hill is empty in like, you know, 15. So, this year, where everybody's going to have to crowd onto one half of the lawn, and we're trying to sort out, still trying to make some amendments to the permit to see if we can sort out what we're going to do in terms of entertainment for the afternoon. So we're working on that, but 4:20 is happening on Parliament Hill. The other problem is, with the construction going on, at any moment, any day, the doozers who are up there on Parliament Hill fixing things, making things right, patching stuff up, doing a good job, hard hat guys, they're going to decide they need that lawn to do whatever they got to do. Either they're going to tear it up and build stuff there, or like, you know, repair things underneath it or whatever, or they're going to park all their trucks there, or who knows what. But right now, on the east half of the lawn is a huge rink, a full-size hockey rink that, you know, there's been hockey games played and people are skating on it and everything's having fun, and it's costing millions of dollars that we didn't really need because we've got skating rinks in town. But there you have it. So by the time April 20th comes around, that piece of lawn might still be quarantined and getting patched. You know, it might be taped off even if there is no construction. So we saw what happened to the lawn. It got destroyed on Canada Day with the whole 150 celebration and the rain that we had for almost a week here in Ottawa. And the lawn got all torn up. There were great big puddles and everyone was up to their ankles in mud. And there's only about 6 or 7 inches of soil sitting on top of a building, right? So, I mean, it's not a lawn. It's more like a window box. It's like a planter you see on a rooftop patio that has little trees or rose bushes or tulips or whatever growing out of it. That's what the lawn is at Parliament Hill. And if it gets too much water on it, it gets really soggy and it can be a real problem. But, you know, we got our hopes up. It's a Friday this year, so we expect that every high school in the whole city will be emptied. You know, legalization of some kind or another appears to be coming. And if this legalization does come, it's going to, it's going to be a bad thing, I think. I mean, it's going to be better than what we have now, maybe. But it all depends on how it's enforced. And that's really where the rubber meets the road on the whole issue. Impresario activist Chris Goodwin in Toronto thinks that it's going to drop from 80,000 arrests down to 800 arrests per year. And it'll just be, you know, main big things and the cops won't bother with it anymore. And I hope he's right. I really do. I hope he's right. But I don't think he is, mainly because the cops and the government are like, oh, there's going to be more police interaction with cannabis users. There's going to be more enforcement. There's going to be more cost and blah, blah, blah. And only in Canada could you screw up legalizing pot, where it's going to cost more money than the revenue brought in by actually having it. But, you know, I guess the first time I tried pot was around when I was 14 years old. And it was a neighbor who was a hash dealer. And he, you know, he gave me my first tokes. And then I had some tokes with some other friends. And this was stuff we used to get from Montreal. But around the same time, I heard this amazing song that I'm going to play right now. It's by Frank Zappa. It's from his Joe's Garage album, Act 3. It's the second to last song. It's called Watermelon and Eastern Hay. And the first time I heard it, I fell in love with it about four bars into it. I said, this is my new favorite song in the world. And it's been my favorite song ever since. And I'm almost 49. So here it is, Frank Zappa with Watermelon and Eastern Hay. Well, there you go. That's Watermelon and Eastern Hay by Frank Zappa, my favorite song. That's why I wanted to share it with you all. Thanks for tuning in. Two things I wanted to get out of the way before we got into the actual news review thing that this show is going to be about. This is just not going to be me talking about my life every time. That was just for the first show. From now on, it's going to be me talking about the news of the past week and, you know, talking about it, interviewing people, hopefully. There's two things. I got a nickname, the angriest pothead in Canada. And I got that from being on the John Oakley show. After I filed a human rights complaint, well, me and this other activist person, we filed a human rights complaint against the Ontario government for failure to properly regulate medical marijuana. I was on the Oakley show, and then they kept having me back on. So one morning I saw the phone number come up, and I recognized it, and it's this guy Victor from Oakley's show. And I pick it up, and I go, "Hey, Victor." And he says, "Hey, Russell, the angriest pothead in Canada." And I went, "Oh, my God, that's really funny, man. We should use that. Use that on the air." So I thought it was a funny nickname. He came up with it, so it stuck with it. I don't really think I'm the angriest pothead in Canada. That probably would go to Alan Park. he does a show called Green Crush, and it's really cool. You should listen to it or watch it on YouTube. And he really brings the fire, probably a lot more than I do. But one last thing, Pottawa at primus.ca. If you've got questions, if you want to contact me, you know, even during the course of the show, that's where you can reach me. Pottawa at primus.ca. Pottawa at primus.ca. So let's get started. Dispensaries in Ottawa. Well, I don't know all my notes in front of me, but it's been a couple of years now, and as far as I know, there's about 19 of them in town. They keep opening up, and then sometimes they close, or they get busted, and then they open them again the next day. But let's focus on sort of the main people, you know, doing activism dispensary in town, which was Cannabis Culture. Now, this place was very popular. It was on Bank Street. They had between, I think they said 1,000 and 1,200 people per day coming through. And they did their best to bring, you know, the best bud and other cannabis products they could to the public. And they got busted. They were open again in 23 hours. Months later, they got busted again. They were open again in, I think it was 31 hours. And then for months, there was all this scaffolding out front. And this did not deter shoppers. People knew where to find the place. They could figure it out. And business kept going. But there's all this scaffolding as the place, the building that housed the establishment, got resurfaced. And then the scaffolding came down and looked very nice. It was all this flat gray stone and looked really good. And then all of a sudden the landlord decides he doesn't want them there anymore. You know, they were completely straight up with them when they rented the place and told them what it was they were doing and what they planned to do and why they were doing it. And he didn't seem to have a problem when he signed them onto his rental property. But it seems within just a couple of weeks of the renovations of the front being done, well, now he wants them out. So they were kicked out. The bailiff or the sheriff or whatever came by, and they were evicted. Locks were changed and all this kind of stuff, and they were told if anybody steps foot back in the place, it would be trespassing. Oh, and the cops took all the bud and some cash and machines and stuff like that too. Well, not to be deterred, Cannabis Culture actually had a sister shop over on Preston Street in Ottawa called Cannabis. And then now there's a new place called Canada's Culture, which was supposed to be a play on words of the Cannabis Culture. And they've used the same font and logo and everything. So at first glance, it looks like Cannabis Culture. If you say it quick, it sounds like it too. And they're out on Baseline, right near Green Bank. Which is way out sort of in the suburbs, but they're getting a lot of people still because a lot of people were coming out from the suburbs downtown to go to their place anyway. And they're going to be opening a lounge soon. They're still working on getting their ventilation system and stuff sorted out. I got friends who work there. Shout out to them. Hopefully they're listening right now. I told one friend that, you know, to put us on when the show was on. So this is what's going on in Ottawa. They're doing, you know, a lot of good business there. We're going to have some people probably interview somebody in the next couple of weeks about from there to talk about what's going on. But, you know, they're doing it from what I've seen at Cannabis Culture. It's the way a pot shop should be. Now, they had to have a buzz-in door, you know, and a sort of a concierge out front because you can't just have people mingling in a store like it's a jewelry shop or something because of the nature of the business. But that's going to change, I suppose, in the future as things, you know, these shops become, the dispensaries become less sort of robbable. But we've had robberies. There was a shot fired just this week where, here we go. This is in the Citizen. We get shots fired, you know, at 613 Medicinals, 274 Montreal Road, Saturday afternoon. Nobody got hurt, but a shot was fired. We've had a lot of shots fired in Ottawa. This is an ongoing problem, shots fired. Not everybody's getting hit by those shots. They can't always find the bullets, but they're finding shell casings, and they're getting reports of shots fired, and which is a drag. And this is why some people, I was just asked yesterday, how come the cops aren't shutting these places down? There's somewhere between 16 and 20 of them operating right now. And the police have publicly stated they simply do not have the manpower. They just don't have the time or the money or the people to go shutting these places down, especially when they get shut down, when they get opened up again the next day. Now, some of the places that got busted shut down and they just disappeared. They packed up shop and they never came back again. And of course, there was that Vice article that exposed all kinds of this franchise across this country. We had three of those locations in Ottawa, and they shut down. They closed the day after, and they were pretty much shut down within 3 or 4 days, like totally paper in the windows, and that was it, vacancy. So it's been an interesting time here in Ottawa. And you have to also consider that Ottawa's not like other cities culturally. From an outsider's point of view, I look at Toronto and Vancouver, and I see a larger collective, a more cohesive kind of community of pot activism, whether it's 420 or other events going on. And you don't, in Ottawa, it's kind of cliquish. There's these small groups of activists, 3-4 people who work in these little squads. And sometimes there's a bit of overlap between groups, but mainly people stay in their own cliques. And that's not a pot thing necessarily. I've asked around and it seems to be kind of an Ottawa thing, whether it's the music scene or the art scene or the, you know, the yoga scene or the theater scene or whatever. Cliques seem to be part of how it works. And I don't think it's a case of people are like, oh, they're so snooty and they stay in their own little cliquey groups and they're snobs. I think it's just a case of, you know, you get your little circle of friends and you work with people you work with, and that's what keeps you busy, you know. So, you know, it's not a malevolent thing. It's just kind of the way it works. But over the past year, it's really been gelling well. You know, we've got some activists here in Ottawa, the young people. There's Alex Newcomb, Sean Mack, Ming Saad, Nathaniel Newcomb, a group of people, you know, Stitch Grady, people working to do different kind of activism things here in Ottawa. Like I was talking about 420. After 420, they're at the local Legion, just a few blocks away from Parliament Hill, there's an after party, big event, fundraiser. It's going to be to help pay the legal fees of some of the people who got busted being bud tenders here in Ottawa. That's the thing with cannabis culture too. Everybody who got hit in those two busts, if they got charges, if they still have charges against them, they've got Kirk Tusaw in their corner or someone who's at least, you know, working with Tusaw. So, and it's all being paid for by the people who own and run the place. That didn't happen in the first busts. Sean Mack, a pal of mine, worked with him on 420 and stuff. He has the distinction of being the first person in Ottawa to be handcuffed during a pot dispensary bust. He's the first guy to take a hit. So, you know, mad props to him. But he got stuck having to pay the bills. Now, somebody stepped in and helped him out, and he's been, you know, getting other help. So he's not coming out of his pocket entirely, as far as I know, But there were other people who just totally got stuck with the bill, and they got no help from the people who own the places. And that's not cool by any standard. And so here in Ottawa, you know, when one place goes down, people are like, oh, no, a dispensary went down. And that's usually pretty bad. But there are some places that are a bit sketchy. I've been into a couple, and you walk in and the bud tender's like, yeah, what Sarah's there, man. And you can just, the vibe is not right at all. And I don't need, you know, tie dye and neon pot leaves and some long haired guy sort of 45 behind the counter go, oh, yeah, man, this strain is really super excellent. And explaining all the things about terpenes to me and stuff. I don't need that, but I don't need this sketchy kind of back alley shell game kind of vibe either, you know? You know, I need bud tenders who know what they're talking about, who know kind of a little bit about the, you know, the stock that they're selling. And, you know, cannabis culture, now called cannabis culture, and cannabis on Preston Street, they do that. That's what's going on there. And they try to, you know, they're running an ethical place and they're digging in their heels, man, because just this week too, they're suing. They're suing the landlord. They're like, no, dude, no, we had a deal. We had a contract and we put a bunch of money into this place, renovating it and everything. And then you just kick our asses out and we're not having it. So, you know, this is the problem law enforcement has. This is the problem that, you know, city elders have, is for every one place that opens up, gets popped and shuts down and you never hear from them again. For every one of those, there's two places that are digging in their heels and saying, yeah, bring it. We'll take this to the Supreme Court of Canada. So, there you have it. This is what's going on in Ottawa, is we've got some dedicated, brave young people. And you got to talk about how brave these people are, man. You know, a lot of the people talk about on the radio, oh, they're just selling drugs. They're just selling pot. They're endangering the community. Thousands of Ottawans are going there. The media is against them. You know, the media has got a bias. You can just see in the tone of every article by this Jackie Miller that they do not like these places. They do not approve. You got to obey the law. But meanwhile, Ottawans, actual citizens, are lining up. They're going in the place. They're keeping the places busy. They're buying lots and lots of product. They're voting with their dollars. They're voting with their feet. These are things that this city needs and wants. And there's 17 or 18 or, like I said, 20 in town, and they're all busy enough, you know, which means there's a huge market for cannabis. So what's going to happen with the future of this? Who knows exactly, but this is what's going on. It's a good town to be in. I want to give props to everybody working at dispensaries. You could get a gun stuck in your face. You could be in handcuffs. You could get that cop who likes kneeling on your neck instead of the cop who just rolls his eyes like, all right, turn around, so I handcuff you and arrest you now. Because some of these cops are really zealous, but a lot of them seem to just be fed up with the whole thing like I am. So let's listen to some beautiful music now. This is also from my teen years. This is from Pat Metheny's live album, one of his live albums. It's called Travels is the album. And this song is called Are You Going With Me? And it's wonderful. Enjoy it.
Hey, this is Cheech.
And this is Chong.
And you're listening to
Lifestyle Radio.
What is it?
Lifestyle Radio. Say it one more time.
420 Radio?
Ooh.
You're listening to Lifestyle Radio.
Thank you.
Okay, well, there you go. Are You Going With Me by Pat Metheny from his live album Travels. And I mean, I just love that tune. It took a little while for it to grow on me, I got to admit, unlike the Frank Zappa tune earlier, but I just love it. So there you go. Something else I wanted to talk about was locally, we have, I mean, I live in Ottawa, but just south of Ottawa is a town called Smiths Falls. And Smiths Falls has this odd distinction of having this great big pot factory and home headquarters of the world's largest pot corporation, Canopy. And, you know, Tweed started there, and they're still growing lots of pot, and they're doing their thing. And, you know, props to them and everything. But I'm not really keen on this kind of stuff. I don't think pot should be grown indoors in factories like that. I think that uses up a lot of, you know, uses up a lot of electricity, excuse me, a lot of light that you could be doing in a greenhouse. Which brings me to this other guy. Recently, a guy got his permit from VRACMPR to start growing pot just south of Ottawa here in what used to be a greenhouse where he was growing tomatoes, beans, and cucumbers for various Ottawa farmer markets. His name is Peter Aboud. He's out on Ramseyville Road. And this place called Metcalf, which is sort of a rural community that's part of Ottawa, because Ottawa is this big rural community area that's part of the city somehow. And he's got 70,000 square feet of greenhouses in the other buildings in the first phase, and then 600,000 square feet in phase two. The rezoning proposal requires the approval of Ottawa City Council. Now, because this is legal pot, ACMPR pot, it'll be, you know, good. And I think this is a good way to go about it. I think pot should be grown in places like greenhouses specifically. Some people say, well, why not just grow it outdoors? Well, the thing about outdoors is you can lose an entire crop to pests, mold, weather. You know, even if you don't get a drought, you can get too much heat that can really cook the plant badly and this kind of stuff. And if you just grow it completely indoors, well, then you've got to just pump in all the light and there's all this ventilation and stuff. So I think a greenhouse is the way to go. The other thing that's important about greenhouses is that you can build them on marginal soil. You don't have to use, farmland, Canadian farmland, to grow pot. I don't see why anybody would do that. You can find some shaggy land. There's plenty of it around Ottawa that grows ragweed all summer, acres and acres and acres of the damn stuff. And you just put up a bunch of greenhouses, put up a bunch of tables, and you just grow hydroponic pot right there. And you can put it all in sections. You can put, you know, small greenhouses and lots of them, or one giant 10-acre greenhouse, or however you want to play it, you know. And it gives you total climate control. It gives you a lot of free light, although you'll probably have to augment the light in wintertime because there's only like 5 hours of daylight in Ottawa in the winter. But I think that – excuse me. I think that's really the way to go is greenhouses. And because – you know, we could get all fussy about, well, we don't want to use farmland, but let's think about it. How much farmland on earth do we use for stupid stuff? Okay. How much farmland goes into feeding cows and keeping cows on the ground and then so that we can make sausages for our dogs? How many acres of lemon trees are used exclusively for things like shampoo for dogs? So things like this, we're not that strict, obviously, or prudent with our farmland as it stands now. So if we wanted to grow pot there, we could grow pot there. The thing that I think is the real future for pot farming is, in terms of outdoor crops, is hemp. And of course, there's, CBD can be extracted from hemp. There's medicinal properties to hemp. There's the stalks that can be used. There's the seeds on top for food. And, the hemp industry is growing in Canada, and a lot of the restrictions were recently – by recently, I mean like last year – were loosened so that you don't have to put up this sort of, maximum security fence around your hemp farm because somebody might come steal some of it. The problem with hemp right now in Canada is there's no infrastructure for processing it. Right now what happens is people come and they cut the hemp down and they take the seeds away and the stalks are left there in a pile to rot. There's nowhere to take them because they're wet and they're heavy, which if you start shipping them around to places to start processing, it's going to become cost prohibitive. If you want to dry it on premises, that's going to be cost and space prohibitive and labor intensive. And if you want to just take the wet green material and start making digesters or stuff right there, well, that's going to be some cost for infrastructure. So a lot of people love to go, oh, hemp will save the world and hemp this and hemp that. Yes, but we're going to need government subsidy. We're going to need private industry to start dumping a lot of money into this industry because otherwise it's not going to grow. You can grow a lot of hemp, but if you're going to be leaving 99% of what you've grown that summer lying in a great big pile at the corner of your farm, just rotting into mulch, into topsoil or whatever, well, that's fine, but that's not the best way to do it, and it's also not the best way to utilize the crop. Who's going to come up with this money? We'll have to wait and see. Anyway, that's my first show. Thank you for tuning in. Before we go, I'm going to let you just hear another nice song, just because it's a nice song, make you feel nice. Nice, nice, nice. Here's Christopher Cross with Sailing. Until next week, only slaves obey. Good night.
Are you looking for cannabis news, education, and people's opinions? Are you looking to learn what Canadian and international cannabis advocates are doing? Not only now, but what got them to this point in their lives, and what does the future hold for them? Do you want to learn how patients are using cannabis as their daily medication, or learn how their cannabis use helps them with their medical condition? If you answered yes to any of these questions, then I'm going to suggest to you to tune in to Lifestyle Radio. Catch their live weekly shows and have your questions and concerns answered and find the experience you're looking for. Monday, catch your weekly news broadcast with the Reef Reporters. Then on Wednesday, get several hours worth of cannabis public education. We get things started with cannabis and coffee with Tamarijuana. Then tune in and catch Pottawa with Russell Barth, who calls himself the world's angriest pothead. Finish up your evening with the award-winning Pace Radio Show with Al Graham and joint host Kim Cooper and Alicia Yashishin. No week would be complete without tuning into Friday night's program, the 420 Radio Show, featuring Al Rapp and the 420 Radio crew, Mary Jane Baker and Marcel Gignac. Cannabis is a lifestyle, and you can catch all your cannabis lifestyle information right here at lifestyleradio.net or at our sister site, 420radio.ca.
Lifestyle Radio.
The opinions expressed during this show are those of the individual participants and do not necessarily reflect the opinions of their associated organizations or Lifestyle Radio.